system. Now, how do we develop a fit for purpose land administration? We'll go through the three key components: the spatial framework, the legal framework, and the institutional framework. Let's start with the spatial framework. Establishing the fit for purpose land administration spatial framework. The spatial framework is a basic large-scale map which shows the way land is divided into spatial units, into parcels, into plots, and for specific use and occupancy. The spatial framework provides a basis for dealing with land administration functions, which are recordation and management of the land rights, assessment of land and property value and taxation, identification and management of current land uses, delivery of land utility services, and administration and protection of natural resources. That's what the spatial framework will allow you to do. Let's remember that when we look at European countries, at developed countries, it took them 2 centuries to establish a country-wide spatial framework using the conventional system, meaning the high accurate conventional method through field surveys mainly. Africa cannot go through a similar process and take today 2 centuries to have a coverage of national territories. This is not acceptable for African countries because they have very urgent development priorities to achieve. For African countries, focus should be made on methods that are fast, cheap, and fit for the purpose. An important prerequisite is the need to ensure that regulations and institutions in charge of maintaining the systems are in place. Put in place the regulatory system and the institutional system. Give preference to using visible boundaries. Visible boundaries will register based on physical elements you can see in the nature. It can be trees, it can be a river, any physical elements that you can use to register, to demarcate your land. While the fixed boundary option will register based on very precise and accurate boundaries using field surveys. I'm saying that the visible boundary option is preferable because the fixed boundary option based on field surveys is too costly, is too time consuming, and is too capacity demanding. Again, let me take an example of my own country, Burkina Faso. I recently got indications of how many cadastral experts we have in the country. This is only 7. So this is not workable for trying to map the whole country. So again, the visible boundary option is the best to adopt for African countries. It will show you the approximate boundary, but remember again, it's adapted to the context, and remember again, it can be upgraded later if there is a need to do so. Let me go first about the benefits of the visible boundary option, because we already commented. It's about the time, it's fast. About the resources, it's less costly. And the purpose is adapted to the needs of African country. And one very important benefit is participation. The boundaries are easily identified by local people through looking at the aerial or satellite imagery, and this allows them to be confident about the demarcation process and to participate even in this process. As I already said, sometimes complementary field surveys might be required. If you are mapping a dense urban area, you need to go with field surveys. So that's not, it's not exclusive if you want. The basis is the visible option, but be open when needed only, to field surveys and very accurate demarcation system. And one very important aspect is that the target is to have a national coverage. That's why you cannot use a system which prevents you from mapping the whole national territory. Here you have a map. I think this is, it's in Ethiopia, where you see people, the villagers, who are looking at the aerial imagery and showing their own parcels, because they were able to recognize their parcel based on the visible boundary option. This is, for example, the tree which is next to such house or so and so. Well, this slide is about the discussion about the accuracy. I won't insist too much on this because we talked to it so much already. Because the accuracy is to be related to the purpose. What do you need? What do you need to document? That's the purpose. So if you are trying to demarcate a pastoral land, I don't think that you need an accuracy of 1 or 2 centimeters. So that's the idea. High accuracy of boundaries should be considered only as an end target. That's the objective, but you don't start with the end target. You start with what is feasible for the country. So you start with the visible option, visible the physical option as entry point. Let me talk about a few elements of the process of establishing the spatial framework. You have the decision-making element. You have the decision to be made on the imagery to be used in the field, and that will allow you to have a participatory approach. Then the result of the process is drawn directly on the imagery. Then the parcels are numbered and connected to identified land rights. Each parcel is numbered and is identified as a land right of such individual. Then the resulting boundary framework is digitalized. So you start with drawing the boundaries on the imagery, and then it's digitalized to serve as a basis for the national land information system. And one good practice is the 80-20% method. 80% of coverage to be realized quickly, not being delayed by 20% difficulties. So this is a 80-20% method. Try to reach the objective of 80% not being delayed by difficult 20% difficulties. Now I'll talk to the legal, I'll talk about the legal framework, which the second key component of the fit for purpose land administration system. Remember that we already said that in most African countries, the existing legal framework are a legacy of the colonial system. That's how we get a system with very poor performance, because mainly because they are not adapted to the local context, and also because they are designed to serve the rights of the elites. In most African countries, the existing framework is often a major constraint for the development and implementation of a fit for purpose land administration approach. And we talked so much about the requirements, the unnecessary requirement of high precision, which is costly and too time consuming. The result of this observation is that national laws should be reviewed and revised in order to remove all unnecessary constraints in the national law and allow an effective fit for purpose land administration system. The legal frameworks aims at providing security of tenure for all through recognizing and recording all legitimate land rights in a national register. The legal framework defines how rights, restrictions, and responsibilities over land are established and managed. Key characteristics of a good legal framework for fit for purpose land administration is to be simple, flexible, inclusive, and that ensures that key principles of fit for purpose land administrations are enshrined in law. It has to be enshrined in law. So these are some of the key elements of a good legal framework for fit for purpose land administration. The legal framework needs to recognize customary-based land rights, because this is a reality on the ground. And we need to review our national laws in order to allow and record all legitimate land rights, including the customary land rights and also some of the informal land occupancy. It's important that the legal framework is also developed in a participatory manner. Some of the elements to be addressed by the fit for purpose legal framework. It includes the types of land, urban or rural land, peri-urban lands, the type of tenure. It has to address the legal tenure, the customary or legitimate tenure, in all informal tenure. The types of rights. It has to address ownership, use rights, servitudes, and other. The procedures of recognition and recordation of land rights. It has also to address the procedure for transferring land rights. When it comes to women's land rights, it has also to adopt principles of affirmative action in order to really facilitate access to land for women. And finally, it has also to include elements on alternative land dispute resolution mechanisms. These are, again, elements to be considered in the legal framework. So I will not go too much into detailed comments. Maybe I can comment briefly on a specific context. In some countries, it may take very long to adapt the national law. So you cannot wait until you have adapted the national law. Let's say it will take you 5 years, 6 years. Sometimes even in certain countries, it takes more. A good practice is to pass an overarching law in order to give legal status to legitimate land rights in areas which are covered by the fit for purpose land administration system. And usually these are areas which are under pilot project. So an overarching law can be adopted in order to give a legal basis to the pilots. In some other examples, the program is engaged and recordation of legitimate land rights can start, and then it's scheduled for legalization later as a second step. Other countries also experienced the practice of provisional certificates to be confirmed and upgraded later. So it's really having a very pragmatic approach if you notice that revising the national law will take too long. So let's be very pragmatic. That's fit for purpose land administration. Now I'm commenting the last aspect of the fit for purpose land administration framework, which is the institutional framework. This is about institutional change. And institutional change is one of the most complex aspects in a land reform. That's the area where you'll find the strongest resistance from existing institutions. Institutions doesn't like being changed because they have already adopted lot of habits, lot of practices, and they don't want this to be changed. So it's necessary to have a flexible approach depending on the country context. Some of these issues that need to be addressed in the context of establishing the institutional framework. First, the institutional fragmentation. Land institutions are usually scattered into different ministries. So this is an area of concern. You need also to address issues of incoherence in the land administration system. For example, land registration services being separated from the cadastral services, land tenure services being separated from land use services, and all this brings a lot of incoherence and difficulty to implement the land administration system. You also need to address conflicts of competences amongst institutions, which are competing over responsibilities to manage land. You can see this competition between the Ministry of Agriculture, for example, and the Ministry of Lands, between the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Urban Affairs, and so on. So these are issues which need to be addressed through looking at the real context of the country. So the journey to fit for purpose land administration institutional framework takes time because it involves cultural change. So the change in the institutional framework need to be made incrementally in order to give time to existing institutions to absorb change. This is really, really very important because the institutional change is the most difficult aspect in a land reform. Failing to make this institutional change will result in non-implementation of the land reform. You also need to promote an integrated institutional framework rather than sectoral silos. We need to go beyond considering only private properties and also address issues of managing public lands. And you have good practices that can be that we can learn from. I have given here an example, surprisingly, from Canada, where you have a board which is in charge of managing the public lands. You have the link, so you can go and check and learn more about this. This is again about being gradual in making institutional change. Very, very important. You need to identify the entry point for the institutional change. You need to facilitate dialogue, inter-institutional dialogue. You need to forge partnerships, especially with private sector. This can contribute in accelerating the implementation of the land reform. And you need to get land delivery service as close as possible to citizens. And this is done through decentralization. So finally, I would say that building the institutional framework is not just about government. It should engage all key stakeholders, including local governments, the private sector, traditional institutions, the CSOs. All stakeholders are concerned by the institutional change. And finally, the land dispute resolution mechanism, the alternative land dispute resolution mechanism, is to be enshrined in law. I will just highlight a best practice here, which is recording the local alternative dispute resolution institution decisions into a specific book. So you have a memory of what is the decision made by the alternative decision, alternative land dispute resolution institution. So this is very simple and it's very useful for people who have been in conflict, as well as for the court, who can go back and see this case was already definitely closed by this alternative decision making. The land information system is also part of the institutional framework, and it's very important because it's a system which allows the capture, storage, and distribution of land information. And land information needs to be adequately managed in order to ensure access to information for all citizens. Let me give you just examples of what type of information can be provided in the system. It provides information on who owns what. It provides information on the price paid for a property. It will also provide information about whether the property seller is the real owner. And it will also provide information on the restrictions to the ownership. When you buy a piece of land, it's very important to know if there is restriction on the ownership, which is about the land servitudes. This slide is just throwing this message that the institutional framework, the improvement of the institutional framework is closely tied to the improvement of the good governance environment. So you cannot isolate this institutional framework from the overall governance system in the country. And finally, the message here is that good land administration is about the people. It's about serving the people. So improving land administration systems is about improving services for the people. Here I'm just discussing the dimension, apparently a conflict between the need to access information, which is very important in terms of transparency and accountability, versus the right for privacy, so which is also a legitimate right. So in most cases, it's advisable to have a robust privacy policy to address this issue. Let me go straight to the experience of Rwanda land regularization program. The Rwanda land regularization program started after the genocide. It started specifically in 2009, after a pilot phase, a brief pilot phase. The objective was to provide legally valid land documents to all rightful landholders. Some of the expected outcomes include social harmony arising from reduced land conflicts, security tenure for increased investment, greater land productivity. You can see that the aspect of social harmony is so crucial for a country who just went out from a genocide process. Rwanda implemented the visible boundary approach. It used high resolution orthophotos, which is a type of aerial imagery, for the provision of geospatial data. The data was collected in a highly participatory manner using those orthophotos. Remember that we said that when you have the imagery, the aerial imagery, the people can participate in the demarcation process. Confirm, yes, this is my piece of land. Yes, these are the boundaries, using the visible boundary approach. One important thing is that Rwanda also recruited teams of data locally trained people. Those people were trained to identify, register visible boundaries. So they didn't wait to train very high level persons to demarcate the land. They trained people directly from the ground. As a result, in 2013, let's say 5 years later, 10 million of persons were registered. 8 million, more than 8 million land lease certificates were issued. And the key lesson is that countrywide documentation of land rights is an attainable objective for African country, provided that they use appropriate land administration system, which is the fit for purpose land administration system. Here you have on the left side the imagery, the aerial imagery. You can see that it's really possible to identify clearly the boundaries, and that each land owner, land user can recognize his piece of land and confirm, yes, these are the right boundaries, and this is done. And on the right side, you have the digitalized image based on the aerial imagery. You can see that it's really reliable, and people will just trust the result of this approach. This is the process of registering and reviewing the land rights. I will not go into much details because I have prepared for you a video, a 10-minute video, only 10 minutes, where somebody is explaining the experience of the Rwanda Land Valorization Program and explaining the process. So it's very clear, very simple. Please watch this video because it will, you will learn in 10 minutes more than what you can learn in 1 hour maybe. Yes, we can say that fit for purpose land administration systems seems very difficult to implement, but let me just quote Churchill, who was saying, "A pessimist sees the difficulty in each opportunity, an optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty." So, thank you very much for your time, and I hope you'll go back and read the narrative of this course, as some aspects might seem a little bit technical. Thank you so much.